In the last lesson, we talked about how the brain receives sensory information. But this information exchange is a two-way street. You have to both receive a stimulus and act on that stimulus almost simultaneously. For example, pretend you're on a street corner and you see a friend on the other side of the road. When you see them, sensory input, you open your mouth to speak, motor action. If you hear your bus pulling away, sensory input, you may have to suddenly break into a sprint to catch it, motor action. Each of these situations is an example of the two-way interaction between the sensory and motor areas. I'm Harrison Canning, and in this video, we will discuss the motor cortex and the pathways through which it communicates with the body. In the last unit, we talked about the somatosensory system and the pathways and brain regions that give us our sense of touch. Motor areas and pathways largely mirror the somatosensory system. This makes sense, right? We have muscles all over the body, just like sensory receptors, and the brain wants to monitor muscle activation to develop an idea of where it is in space and prevent damage. Remember our friend Homunculus from the last video? Well, he makes an appearance here again, this time as the motor cortical homunculus. Similar to sensory homunculus, the motor homunculus is also organized so that each area of the motor cortex corresponds to a specific muscle group. This is largely the same across different people. To discover and prove this map, neuroscientists have electrically stimulated motor regions and watched as different parts of the body exhibited movement. Motor pathways are some of the most well-studied parts of the nervous system. This knowledge allows neurotechnologists to tap into these regions to develop a control system for advanced exoskeletons and robotic prosthetics that work using natural neural signaling. Since muscle commands originate in the brain, this will be our area of study. Before executing a movement, the brain must first understand where the body is in space, proprioception, and where it intends to move to. This model is built using incoming sensory information. This kickstarts a chain of neural impulses that move through different regions. First, the posterior parietal cortex is activated, indicating the intent of movement. Next, the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex is activated, which anticipates movement and forms a plan of action. Then, the premotor or secondary motor cortices create a specific plan of attack, such as imagining the movement. Finally, the primary motor cortex, the region that is mapped out by the homunculus, executes on the plan and sends motor commands out to the body. For years, many neuroscientists believed that specific neurons or groups of neurons in the primary motor cortex were responsible for controlling individual muscles. As it turns out, the movement generation process involves specific populations of neurons. This finding was first presented in a 1982 paper by Apostolos Georgopoulos and colleagues. And yes, I am partially including this because I wanted to say his freaking awesome name. Georgopoulos trained monkeys to move a ball from a center point to highlighted locations on a circle while recording from 200 neurons in the monkey's primary motor cortices. The neurons showed a directional correlation to the monkey's physical movements. Certain neurons were more associated with moving forward, some back, some left, and some right, and everywhere in between. When a monkey moved its arm forward, the neurons representing that direction fired with a high intensity, while the neurons associated with the opposite direction fired minimally. By collecting the rate of firing from many neurons associated with the movement, a vector can be drawn that indicates the direction of motor movement. This process is called population coding, and it is important for developing BCIs that use motor inputs. We wanted to walk you through these processes so that you understand that motor actions are complicated and involve many areas of the brain. The premotor and motor cortices, however, are some of the most important for our purposes. By recording from these areas, we can monitor motor intention or execution and use that to control a system. As we will see later, this can be life-changing for people in locked-in states because it gives them a way to interact with the world by controlling robotic limbs or a computer. As this advances and we can record from more of these areas, we will be able to control avatar and exoskeleton movement with greater accuracy. In this lesson, we learned about how the brain gets the body to move, that we have an excellent map for the motor cortex through our friend Homunculus, and that there are many brain regions that are involved in this process. In the next video, we will shrink ourselves down to enter the world of the neurons.